In this video, we're going to look at some of the probing options available. This is how we interface the Analytic Discovery 2 scope to the outside world to measure signals on our device under test. We're going to look at the 10X probe, some jumper wires that come with the scope using discrete wires, and I've got a couple of other techniques available here I'm going to show you. Really important to pay attention to the bandwidth of the signals that we're trying to measure. If we're looking at signals that have frequency components less than about a megahertz, or rise times that are longer than about a microsecond, almost doesn't matter what the probes or the fixtures are we use. They're not going to affect the signals. We say those interconnects are transparent. But if we want the highest performance, if we want to push the limit, get close to what the scope is capable of, we're going to always be using the 10X probe, and we'll see lots of examples of this. Keep in mind, the scope that we're using, it's a low-end scope. It's only got a 35 megahertz bandwidth. That means that even if we sent a 1 picosecond signal in, the shortest rise time we're going to measure is about 10 nanoseconds. And we'll see the impact of that in measurements later on. If we're looking at rise times that are long at about a microsecond, doesn't really matter what the probe is we use. Always a good habit to keep the signal and the returns close together. We'll see, again, many examples of this. And we'll also point out, really important to keep in mind, that what the scope is actually measuring is a differential input, the voltage between the plus and minus inputs to channel 1. And that minus input on channel 1 is not the same as ground. And I'm going to show you a couple of examples of what we do with that minus input to get the best measurements. So let's get started. We'll take a look at the scope and various interfaces. Here is my Analog Discovery 2 scope. You'll notice that I've got the USB connection over here. Be careful of this because it's not a very good connection. If you move the scope around, sometimes it'll jiggle out and it'll lose connection. And so just be aware of that. And so if you can keep it stable and not move it, that'll help a lot. The input to the scope is actually over here, of course, on this side. And we can see we've got the connector with the pins over here. It's all about interfacing those pins. And you're gonna want to look very closely to the labels here. We have the very first ones. It's the channel 1. You can see it's plus and minus of channel 1. Here's channel 2. These are the inputs to the analog part of the scope, plus and minus. It's a differential input. And so we're always looking at the voltage difference between these two. The little down arrow, that means that these pins, third over, are going to be ground pins. And then here is a power supply, plus and minus voltage. And then here, W1 and W2, these are the outputs to the function generator. And it's got grounds next to them. And then these are related to other features that we're not going to be using much of in this particular class, but they're still really important. So here's the quick heads up. We're always going to be measuring the voltage difference between the plus and minus of each of the channels. If we're looking at a signal that's single in, it's reference to ground, then we're going to want to connect the minus input to ground. If we just let the minus input float, not connect it anywhere, and we connect the signal we want to look at to the plus one input and then ground to our board, we're going to get noise. We're not going to be seeing the voltage difference between that input and ground. And so always keep in mind, if you're looking at a single-ended signal, you're going to want to connect the minus input to ground. Let's take a look at some of the different interfaces we have available. The first is, hey, I've got an adapter to go to a BNC. And for the BNC, we have, again, we get the connector on the inside. We literally just plug it in. It's keyed. And then that will connect the two important types of interfaces for us. These are going to be the input channels to the scope. And remember, I just said we measure a differential signal. Well, this board connects the minus input to ground for us. And so we look at single-ended signals coming off the BNC. If we want to look at a true differential signal, which we will later in the course, then we cannot use this interface because it only gives us the option of connecting the minus input to ground, and that means we're automatically looking at single-ended signals. If we want to look at a differential, we have to unplug it and use something else. This interface with the BNCs, when we connect the 10X probes, is going to give us the highest bandwidth. And we get two 10X probes in this kit. Here's one of those 10x probes. We're going to be using these quite a bit later on, and we'll go through the details on how the 10x probe works. We're going to be plugging it into the two channels of the BNC. So we have the input channels over here to the scope, and we have the waveform generator outputs over here that we can use with other BNC connectors. The other important thing to keep note of is here we have a couple of little blue shorting flags. These let us change the input coupling from DC to AC. There are almost no situations where using AC is important. I strongly recommend you take a look at those flags, keep it on DC as a default. And so always pay attention to those flags and always keep it on DC unless you have a strong compelling reason otherwise. And likewise for the function generator, we want to keep it on the 50 ohm outputs for the function generator. For the highest bandwidth, this is the interface that we're going to use. But for simplicity, here's another interface that comes with the Analog Discovery 2 scope. It's just a whole bunch of jumper wires. And you'll notice that they're all discrete wires. So we have two rows of connectors here, and you can see that one of them is striped and one of them is solid. You know, it's keyed in the front, and so there's only one way of plugging this in to the AD2 scope. So we plug it in, we've got it plugged in, and now we can see that channel 1 is orange, the solid orange is the plus, and the striped orange is the minus of the input. Next to it in blue is channel 2. And you'll notice when we turn on the scope, channel 1 comes up the default orange trace, and channel 2 comes up the default blue trace. How convenient is that? We can color code the traces on the scope and each of the wires that go to the device under test. The next one over, the two grounds, they're black. How convenient. And those are ground. All the grounds are connected together. They're all in parallel. And the next one over is a voltage supply we're not going to be using. And the next one over, yellow, is the waveform generator. And this is the one that's going to give us the different signals coming out. And you'll notice that next to the waveform pin is ground. And look, conveniently, that is black. So Digilent has done a really nice job in color coding the wires to make it easy for us. One thing to note is, look, these wires are separated. They're not coupled together. And that means it's possible to have them routed with a large space in between them. Generally not a good thing to do, but again, below about a megahertz bandwidth or rise times longer than about a microsecond, it's almost a who cares. So for now, what we're going to do, don't worry about it, but we'll see the impact of that a little later on. So this is one of the common interfaces, and we'll be using this initially just to get started. And now I've brought a couple of other interfaces with me to illustrate what we can do. This is a breakout board from the connectors from the scope into a solderless breadboard. So it's just going to make it easy for us if we connect this in. It's just going to make it easy for us to interface the signals that we would create on our solderless breadboard into the scope. And then finally, here's another really cool interface. Sometimes it's referred to as a dragon tail. These are the pins that are the sockets that the scope would plug into. Here's the breakout board. And again, it's a simple way of interfacing the scope's inputs into a breakout board, so we can now connect it to the solderless breadboard. And so we would connect this in vertically. And now we've instantly instrumented a solderless breadboard and made it into a smart solderless breadboard. So these are a couple of different ways that we can interface our Analog Discovery 2 to the outside world. And then finally, I'll mention one other way that I like to use sometimes, and that's using discrete jumper wires. Remember, we have male pins on the input, and so we need a female end in order to connect to the Analog Discovery 2 input. And then the other end is, in this case, is male. It plugs into some other device under test. One of the advantages of using this discrete cable is, look, they're still connected on the ribbon cable. We would be connecting the 1 plus and the 1 minus together in close proximity, and that would give us a little bit better performance. It's going to give us a little less distortion, and more importantly, less crosstalk between channels. And again, we'll see details of that later on. So as a starting place, if we're talking about low bandwidth signals, no problem at all starting out with our discrete jumper wire header. We're going to plug that in, and we're going to do our initial measurements in this configuration.